All right, guys, we are going to look to finish up the FG4 notes here, talking about the different graphs of functions and the key features of these graphs. So we've already covered definitions, we've looked at some examples, now let's look at a couple different types of examples. So here in problem number 3, they give us a table for a function. They say a continuous function f of x. So this word continuous means basically that this function is going to not have any breaks in the function. So in algebra 1, you talk about piecewise functions. This is not a piecewise function. It's going to, every point is going to connect and go, it's going to just be a nice, smooth, continuous path. So a continuous function, f of x, has a domain where x is greater than or equal to negative 6 and less than or equal to 13. So that's telling us that x only exists from negative 6 to 13, with selected values shown below in that table. The function has exactly 2 zeros and exactly 2 turning points, one at 3, negative 4, and one at 9, 3. So 2 zeros, this word zeros is another word for x-intercepts. So we talked about x-intercepts. We see the word zeros and sometimes solutions. These just mean x-intercepts. The 2 turning points are going to be our relative maximums and relative minimum points. Now, we could try to sketch out a graph for this, but we can also answer these questions based on the table. So it says, state the interval over which f of x is less than 0, or state the negative interval, where the y value is going to be less than 0. That's what this expression means. So it's a negative interval. So what we know is we have a turning point. What we know is we have 2 zeros, 2 places where we touch the x-axis. So we're going to touch the x-axis here at negative 1. We're going to touch the x-axis here at 8. So remember that positive and negative intervals always begin and end on the x-axis, or just next to the x-axis. So our interval, our negative interval here, is going to begin to the right of negative 1. And it's going to continue until we reach 8. So the reason that we have that interval as negative 1, 8, let's just get a rough sketch. So if I have this point here at negative 1 where it intersects the x-axis, and this point here at 8 where it intersects the x-axis, and we know, we can see by these numbers right here that y is negative between those or less than 0 between those, it's going to do something like this. We don't know exactly what it's going to do, but it's going to do something like that. So we can see that it is negative after you pass negative 1 on the x-axis, and it is negative all the way up until you reach 8 on the x-axis. So our interval is going to begin at negative 1 and end at 8. It also says state the interval over which f of x is increasing. So where the x values are rising, this is where our turning points are going to come into play. So remember, functions continue to increase or decrease until they reach a turning point. So this is a turning point right here, 3, negative 4. I'm going to go ahead and mark that. Just put a little dash over the top. That's a turning point, and 9, 3 is a turning point. So my increasing intervals are going to exist on one side or the other, maybe between those. So what I want to do is look at the y values. When are the y values increasing? Well, this goes from 5 to 0. So that's decreasing. 0 to negative 2, that's decreasing. 0, negative 2 to negative 4, decreasing. Negative 4 to negative 1, now I begin to increase. So from this turning point at 3, negative 4, I'm starting to increase. So we list by x values, so x exists from 3. Now we continue, I'm increasing from negative 1 to 0, I'm increasing from 0 to 3, and then from 3 to 1, I'm decreasing. So this turning point would be the end of my interval. So we looked at those definitions with a full picture of a graph, and we were able to come up with intervals or points, locations for each of those different types of definitions that we looked at in FG4 notes leading into this example. Now we can still find the same thing for a function where they just give us a table if we take a look at the y values, what's happening to the y values, and we correspond those to given x values. Now let's take a look at the final example of the notes, problem number 4. So it says, consider the function g of x, which equals 2 times the absolute value of x minus 1, minus 8, over the domain, negative 4 to 7. So it's telling us we're just looking at negative 4 on the x to 7 on the x. We want to sketch a graph of the function. So we could sketch this graph by hand, probably. We know that we have a horizontal shift to the right 1 from the axis and down 8 from the axis, or from the origin, sorry. And we have a slope of 2, but we could also use the calculator to help us out. So I'm going to go ahead and put this into the calculator. If you don't need it, perfectly fine to graph this without the calculator. But we're going to have it just to make sure that we graph everything correctly. So x minus 1 would be inside the absolute value, minus 8. I'm going to set my window here to the interval. So my window is way off. It's from a previous problem. But I'm going to set it from negative 4 to 7. Negative 4 is going to be my minimum on the x. Negative 4 there. And 7 is going to be my maximum on the x. Now I'm going to hit zoom. I'm going to go down to zoom 0, which is zoom fit, so that it'll set up my window. So this is my graph here. And if it helps, we can take a look at the table to help us plot some points. So negative 4, 2 would be a point that we're going to have on the graph. Negative 3, 0 would be a point. Negative 2, negative 2. Negative 1, negative 4. Get that at negative 4. Negative 1, negative 4. 0, negative 6. 1, negative 8. 2, negative 6. We're kind of mirroring this image back the other direction until we get all the way down, start all the way over to 7, 4. And then we can connect the dots here and draw in our function. That a little bit more accurate so that it goes through my points. And there we go. Now we have the absolute value function g of x. So this function is g of x. Now I'm going to go ahead and label some points here. I'm going to label this turning point. This turning point was 1, negative 8. I'm going to label my x-intercepts. So I had an x-intercept of 5, 0, and negative 3, 0. I'm going to label my y-intercept at 0, negative 6. So I'm labeling these points because these points are going to be the most common points we're going to use to help us identify intervals or key features of the function. So it says state the domain interval over which this function is increasing. So if we take a look again, we have this domain restriction here. So this domain function is increasing here starting at 1 on the x-axis, or the x value of 1, the x-coordinate of 1. It's going to start increasing once we move to the right of 1. And as I continually move to the right, this is increasing, 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 increasing. It never stops increasing, but our function does stop. It stops at 7. So this is going to increase from 1 to 7, and it's still increasing when we get to 7. So I'm going to put a bracket around 7 here, and this is something we haven't seen quite yet. We've usually ended every increasing interval with a set of parentheses because it's either been a turning point where it's no longer increasing or decreasing, or it's gone to infinity. This one, because of the restriction on the domain where they tell us to stop this graph at 7, we're still increasing when we reach 7. So we want to make sure we include 7 as part of that interval. So state the zeros of the function. Remember, zeros just mean x-intercepts. So we did label those x-intercepts. Hopefully you can pick those out. This would be where x equals negative 3, or where x equals 5. So we have two zeros, two x-intercepts, two solutions to this function. So state the interval over which g of x is less than or equal to 0. Notice right here that this is less than or equal to 0. So this is not exactly a negative interval. It's kind of like a negative interval, but now it's including where the y value, or g of x, the y value is 0. So I can start right here at negative 3 because my y value is 0 there at negative 3. I'm going to put a bracket around negative 3 because, again, we are including 0 in this interval. Then I'm going to go ahead and this, all of this here, as I move from left to right from negative 3, all of this would be less than 0, continues to be less than 0 on the y, until I get back to this point right here. At this point, we are no longer less than 0. We are equal to 0, but that's where we're going to end. Because if I move past 5, I move past this 5, now that's going to be a y value of greater, or a g of x value of greater than 0, so this would not be part of our interval. So it's kind of like a negative interval, but here, because we're including 0, we have to make sure we include the negative 3 and the 5 in our interval. In E, it says evaluate g of 0 by using the algebraic definition of the function. So g of 0 means to put 0 into the function for x. So this is something we talked about earlier in this unit. Let's go ahead and take a look at this. And you can type this into the calculator, but let's just solve it by hand. So 0 minus 1 inside the parentheses, or inside the absolute value, would be negative 1. Remember, an absolute value changes a negative to a positive, so this is like having 2 times 1 minus 8. 2 times 1, let's continue this, 2 times 1 is just 2, minus 8 is negative 6. So g of 0 is negative 6. And it says, what point does this correspond to on the graph? Well, we should know that this is the y-intercept. The y-intercept is any time the x value is going to be 0. And so if we substitute in a 0, algebraically we can find the x-intercept. Or we can look at this graph and see that that point is there graphically as well. Finally, the last question says, are there any relative maximums or minimums on the graph? If so, which and what are their coordinates? So this is a kind of a tricky question. Relative maximums and minimums. Remember, by definition, relative maximums and minimums are turning points on the graph. Turning points on the graph are relative maximums and minimums. It's not always just the highest or lowest point of the graph. So we do have a relative minimum. I'll abbreviate here, relative minimum. You should be able to pick out that relative minimum point. That minimum point is 1, negative 8. Now, what I would often get is people might say that these two locations on the graph are relative maximums. However, remember, by definition, to be a relative maximum, an interval has to change from increasing to decreasing. And there's no change here. We don't turn on these points. So these points are high points on the graph of some kind. They're above other points in their area, but they are not a relative max or a relative minimum. So we have one relative minimum, and it is 1, negative 8. And with that, we have completed the FG4 notes. So at this point, you would be able to complete anything in the FG4 homework. We will have time in class to work on this homework on Wednesday when we reconvene in class, and then you guys will have the opportunity to ask some questions, get some practice before we take a quiz. As always, thank you guys for tuning in, and I'll see you.